Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. What a wonderful privilege and opportunity to be in the presence of their grace, His Grace Bishop Moussa and His Grace Bishop Thomas, whom we really love so much, and we appreciate all the efforts they did to come especially to be with us. So we have to really give them a huge big hand. You know, when His Grace Bishop Moussa started to speak about the 4-H Club, he took me back about 30 years ago, because I heard the same lecture from His Grace 30 years ago around when I was your age. Does this give away my age?
They could guess.
They can guess. And you know, these words really affected me as a young person, coming from a blessed bishop who came to visit us in Toronto. And I even used to attend as well other youth conventions at that time. And here His Grace comes again to teach a new generation. And I want you to think that some of you, because at that time I didn't imagine that I'll be here at this time, in this capacity. But you can imagine that some of you, 5, 10, 15, 20 years from now, will assume a leadership role in the church. So we're really thankful to His Grace Bishop Moussa for coming to us, especially this year is very special. You know why? Why is this year is very special? It's the 25th anniversary since the commencement of the ECCYC in 1989. So thank you so much, Your Grace, for being with us. I'm also thankful for His Grace Bishop Thomas for coming and blessing us with his presence as well. Amba Thomas is very dear and special to us as well, and I always say that I love Amba Thomas's examples, right? Know that he makes very analogies and examples. That you did you hear about the story of the tree that you sing for the tree? Maybe he will tell it to us sometime. he has very nice stories that relate to life. And of course, His Grace Bishop Thomas as well visited us in Toronto. So although his yani doesn't seem to be that old, but he was ordained as a very young bishop, and he came to us in Toronto, and the priest in Toronto at that time told us a story. Once the first time we met His Grace Bishop Thomas, he said that he was a very young bishop, and the people thought that he is a very young bishop, but then they found out how much wise he is. So they trusted his wisdom and his leadership, even as a young bishop. Like St. Timothy was a young bishop, but he had a lot of wisdom and leadership. So we're very thankful for having their grace with us to bless us in this convention. And we cannot have it without the presence of their grace, of course. I should be learning from their grace, but out of their love and humility, they gave me some questions to answer. So I want to actually listen and learn, because I am their son, but I'll just, out of obedience, I'll answer a couple of questions. Why does Satan want us to fall? Because it is his job. It is his job to tempt us, because His kingdom is against God's kingdom, right? We have two kingdoms here. Do you remember in the gospel where the Lord opened the eyes? He healed someone who was demon-possessed, and he was blind and mute. And when the demons came out, he was able to see and to speak. Some people said he does so by Beelzebub, the ruler of the devil. Then the Lord said, This cannot happen because it would mean that devils are against themselves. And the kingdom of the devil would not stand. As if the Lord is saying, look around you. See how the kingdom of the devil is very strong because they are so united. See? So they are so united in doing evil, in tempting us, in wanting us to fall. But then he said, the Lord said, but if by the hand of God or the finger of God I cast out demons, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. So in this same gospel, he's speaking about the kingdom of the devil, which is very strong because they are so united, and the kingdom of God. We are supposed to be the members of the kingdom of God. And to fight the devil, as His Grace was just saying to us, we have to fight. It is a spiritual fight. In fact, I remember His Holiness Pope Shenouda used to say, no one can be crowned except him who overcomes. No one overcomes except him who fights. And no one fights except him who has an enemy. Therefore, God spared the devil to be the enemy in order that we fight him, in order that we overcome and we receive the heavenly crown. So it is his job, and we don't blame him for doing his job, because this is, he is fighting the kingdom of God. But let us also do our work. Okay, let me end with a story. One time it was in the monastery, the robbers came in to steal, and one of the monks saw them. He ran to the abbot, and they were praying in the church. He said to the abbot, we have to do something. The robbers are stealing our things. Then he said to him, let them do their work, and let us do our work. What is their work? They are robbers. Their work is to steal. And let us do our work. What is our work? We are monks. To pray. So let the devil do his work, and let us do our work for the kingdom of God.
Thank you, Sayedna, for the nice words that you say. We love you a lot, and we are very blessed by being here with you. Thank you. Big hand to be Bishop. His Grace is a wonderful person, and we are all learning as well from him, because he is always showing a great hospitality and great wisdom, and he has actually a very beautiful presence around him, angelical presence. Thank you for being who you are. You see, we when we meet all the bishops, we really feel joy to meet one another. You know that? So when we say nice words like this, it's not for you. Actually, we express it from the depths of our hearts. So we really feel joyful when we meet one another. So three bishops together, this is something great.
I meet with Sayyidina Amba Thomas in America. More than in Egypt.
And of course, we are enjoying the presence of Amba Moussa tremendously. He made this year the biggest impact on us, that he filled us with great joy. So thank you. I think this is also a good sermon, right?
once we were... We were leaving after a convention. I don't remember exactly where. But we are taking the car, and somebody came to me and knocked on the glass of the window. I opened. He said to me, "You didn't benefit from your lectures. We benefited from the love that you are living together."
Thank you. So this is a question here. How can we say no to others without making them feel like we are judging them? Of course, one of the most important things in life as well is not always to say yes to everything, but to say no is a half of our decisions, actually, is to say no. To say no is halfway freedom, and to say yes is the other half. So that means that there are many decisions in our lives that we have to say no, simply. And to say no, that doesn't mean that you put the other person outside of the circle of love. So the first thing that you need to do, actually, to have in your heart, inside, the feeling that this other person are still in the circle of love. The circle of love doesn't always apply to people that you really are agreeing with. You can say no, you can disagree with other people, and you still keep them in the circle of love. And anyway, as Christians, we have to keep all people in the circle of love. As we are the image of God, we are supposed to be His likeness, we are the image of Christ, then the whole world in the circle of love, in God's eyes. And we are His image, we are His children, we are His likeness. That means all people has to be in the circle of love in our eyes. So the first point, that you yourself, you would feel that. As soon as you start to feel that inside you, the softness of love that's inside you will be radiating to the other person. So first start from inside and then go to the other side. The second point here as well to say no is you have a reason for saying no. You can't just say no without a reason. Make a good, nice introduction of putting the positive things in the other person and the positive things in the topic, and then start to say as well the good reason for saying no, and after that you end up with a positive motto in your words. That means that the person would start to direct his mind or her mind towards the objective of your no, not the feelings of your no, which is it's a different dynamics here. So when people are starting to see that you have a reason, will make it easier for them. The third point, you need to know a little bit of the character and the perception mechanism of the other person. And that means that when you start to understand about your personality and about the people that you befriend with, then it will be much easier for you to say no without hurting them. Meaning, there are people that they understand much easier. Their perception would be analytical or visual or hearing or feelings, different kind of people. And when you are able to see that character in them and you use this method, you use the tools that they understand or the language that they understand, it will make it easier for them to accept the no. The no here, without a reason, is creating confusion. A no with a clear reason will bring more friendship because there is a communication between the persons to one another. Thank you.
somebody is asking, is it wrong to defend yourself? Defend yourself. Sure, no, it's not wrong. It can be a very important thing to do it. I'll tell you very brief points. It's your right by law to defend yourself. And if you use law, it's something natural and expected. Go ahead. Number two, if you don't defend yourself, such an accusation, which is fake or false, can be a stumbling block to others. Why to be a stumbling block? If you can defend yourself and didn't commit that, go ahead. And number three, very few saints used to do that. It's a level of holiness that is not, you know, needed for us because we are so weak to have this level of holiness. Like what Jesus himself didn't defend himself. He is the holy capital H. And a lot of saints didn't defend themselves. They were holy small H. And for sure, after things passed and the people knew that they didn't defend themselves, they became in their lives heroes and saints and good examples for the Christian life. It's your right to defend yourself, go ahead. But some occasions and some people maybe ask it for a level of holiness that not all of us can achieve. How does one keep his peace and holiness in a troubled house? At home, to be a pacemaker, not a peacemaker. Originally, I'm a physician. I found it easy to say pacemaker. But I ask you to be both pace and peacemakers. Yeah, because the pacemaker is regulating the, you know, the heartbeats. And you at home, if you are a true Christian, you are going to get the beats of the and the impulses at home to be, you know, acceptable and bearable, and then you can be a pacemaker. You can be also a peacemaker whenever you find somebody, you know, in conflict with another. Don't take one side because of emotions or because of egocentrism. But better than that is to be the peacemaker between them. And you are going to achieve a very happy experience when you make peace. Our Lord Jesus Christ made peace between the governors while he was in the court. And he was all the time searching for peace between earth and heavens, between Jews and Gentiles, between body and psyche and soul. He is always the peacemaker. Therefore, I hope that all of us can be peacemakers. Thank you very much.
It's a bit long, but a very good question. Let me read the question, then I'll tell you why I grabbed this board. So, our parents teach us to work hard, study, etc., so we are financially secure and have a prestigious standing. Does this conflict with the church's view about riches, luxury, and entering the kingdom of heaven? If it doesn't conflict, why do monks and nuns give up everything? Is there any other way to be perfect as Christ commands? So, why do I like this question and why did I grab this? Because once I entered the room and I saw, did you see that? I don't know who made it or what it is really for, but I but I saw it. So I thought, Ida, دزودوا هنا شوية هنا شايفين الحتة دي. When I came in, it was up to this line. Now it increased a little bit. The orange, the orange, the orange here is probably some.
Yes, they're adding.
في شغل يعني. So let me speak to you a little bit about the concept of giving. Okay? When the young rich man came to the Lord and he said to him, what should I do to inherit eternal life? He said to him to keep the commandments. Okay? So, what is required from us is to keep the commandments to inherit eternal life. But then he said, I have kept all that since my youth. Then the Lord continued by saying, if you want to be perfect, to live a life of perfection, you have to do what? Go and sell what you have, give it to the poor, come and follow me, you will have treasure in heaven. Okay? Go sell what you have, give it to the poor. Come and follow me, taking up your cross, and you will have treasure in heaven. I always like to say the following. Let us see what that young man heard and what did he, what slipped his mind or his hearing. Did he hear, if you want to be perfect? He didn't hear that, right? Did he hear, go sell what you have? He heard it very well and it gave him a heart attack, right? ما كانش عنده pacemaker. It gave him a heart attack, right? Like, قلبي. He wasn't expecting that, right? وبعدين, okay, maybe I will sell it, but I will keep most of it. He said, give it to the poor. Did he hear that? He heard that very well. دي خلصت عليه يعني. وبعدين, did he hear, you will have treasure in heaven? He didn't hear that. Because sometimes we feel when we give, it is lost. It's no longer in our bank account. It is given away. But it is kept in heaven, right? And come and follow me. Let me tell you that as young generation, we still have a long way to learn the concept of giving. Why do I say that? In fact, I spoke to many fathers and young people, maybe older than you. I say to them, why don't our young people understand the concept of giving? Although when the Lord taught us in Matthew chapter 6, he said to fast, to give, and to pray. These are the three pillars of our worship. But we have to understand the concept of giving. Monks and nuns were able to give everything. Right? But this is not expected from everyone. What is the minimum? What is the minimum to give? 10%? Is it 10%? Let me tell you a story. I have many stories with His Holiness Pope Shenouda, so allow me to say one. So His Holiness Pope Shenouda was sitting in Cleveland with one of the bishops, not me. I don't know even who it was. Actually, I know who it was because I remember now the one with whom this story took place, he said it to me. So someone came to him and gave him an envelope, okay, which had some cash as a donation. So His Holiness's way was always to teach. So he said to him, you know, the Lord taught us to give our tithes. So he opened the envelope and he counted and it was $10,000. So he gave him $1,000, which is the 10%. And then he took $100 more, one bill. It was all $100 bills. So he gave him one more And he said, because the Lord Jesus said, unless your righteousness exceeds the Pharisees, you will not enter the kingdom. So he was teaching him a little bit over 10%, because the 10% was in the Old Testament, but our love should exceed that minimum, which is the 10%. This money belongs to God. It's not mine. And it's not before we pay our bills. I mean, it's not after we pay our bills. So when you pay all your bills and what is left, you give the tithes. No, it is from your income, from your net income, and sometimes from the gross income, right? So if you are rich, be rich in good deeds, right? Be rich in good deeds. If God has given you richness and success, consider this a gift from God. And at least the minimum is to give the 11%, because it's a little bit over 10%. And then out of love, the more love you have for God and for His kingdom and for His people and for His church, you will be able to give more, right? And you will be rewarded according to how much you give, because giving equals how much love. Because we have to give out of love, not out of someone will put his hands in your pocket and take your money. You do it by your own choice, out of love for God, out of love for His church, out of love for His people, out of love for the kingdom. Because you have to understand that although we are spiritual, the church is a spiritual entity, yet it lives in the world. We live in the present world. And in the present world, there has to be expenses. For example, the church, there is electricity, there is utilities, etc. So, in fact, I spoke to the fathers and said, at one point, we have to teach our children, because this generation, your generation, feels that this is the church of your parents. Many of the parents, they give to the church, but you still need to feel that this is your church. And you have to understand that even if you're not working yet, if you allow تاخدوا allowance, you have to pay the tithes out of your allowance. And then I said to the parents, you teach your children something wrong. He said, why? I said to them, you give them $1 to put in for the Sunday school. $1. Why don't you give them $20 or even more, so that they know to give is to be generous in giving. And then subtract it from your tithes. But if you give them $1, then what's $1? Anyway, if God has given you a lot, then you have to give Him back a lot and say, من يدك إيه أعطيناك. From all your own hands, we give you back. You have given me all that, but I'm giving you back from what you have given me. You have given me 100%, and you're asking me for just a little bit over 10%. So we want to be, as God has been generous to us, we have also to be generous in giving. And it's not wrong to live a good life. And it is also good to be generous in giving and loving, to feel the needs of the others, and to have the love of God before you give, because you give out of your love.
Thank you, Sayyidina, very much. Is it wrong to feel guilt for your sins? Is it wrong to feel guilt for your sins for extended periods of times? Sure, it's wrong. But also it's beneficial. It can be of benefit. But don't exaggerate. Yes, after committing a sin and after confessing and repenting, I must feel the joy of repentance, one. The joy of the fellowship of Christ, two. The joy of the Holy Communion, three. And you can add the joy of service, four. Then you are going to change the atmosphere of sin that is always getting us down, to have repentance getting us up. It's mentioned in Luke 15, when the prodigal son came back home, they started to rejoice. It's written in the Bible. Therefore, please, whenever I commit a sin and repent, I must feel joyous with the Lord that is forgiving me. Another question, how do we grow in trust of God, especially in situations that may be difficult of the moral opinion of the outside society? Now, you know, having the Lord with you and inside you, you are going to be conquerors, as we said, of this world, thoughts and negative thinking. You are convinced in your mind that you are behaving in the right direction. And even as Sayyidina said from a few minutes, be leaders and not followers. Somebody's asking you, what about your situation? Why you sinned that? Yes, I sinned, I confessed, I am now repenting, I am now taking the Lord in the Holy Communion, I am now serving in the church, come and serve with me. Be positive and not negative, please. If you are positive, you are going to benefit a lot and benefit a lot of people around you. Another question, you said in the beginning, baptism doesn't make us resistant to temptation and sin. It gives us power to overcome. Is it possible to overcome temptation and sin for those who aren't baptized? Actually, those who are not baptized morally can overcome a lot of things negative, morally, but not the nature of sin inside. Baptism gets us to die with the Lord, be resurrected with the Lord, changing our nature from the inside and getting the sin inside to be outside us through the Lord, dwelling inside us instead of sin. Therefore, it's not a matter of moral appearance or moral behavior. It's an essential thing inside. The essence of repentance is taking the Lord inside. وقال له ايه زكا؟ Zacchaeus said to the Lord, come and keep in my home for this night. We are asking the Lord to make our hearts homes for his residence, and when he resides in us, everything will be okay for sure. Thank you very much.
A question is saying, I have a friend who's struggling with homosexuality. He is very open to me about it, looking for help. But I'm not sure what to do. Please help. It's very beautiful that this person who are in a struggle is asking for help. And this is one of the good signs for your question. We need to have a clear understanding about the real stand of Christianity concerning certain matters. Human beings are always, wherever they are, wherever they do, they are always loved. They are always there to be carried. They are always in the care and the love of God.
So the first thing, actually,
is to be present in a psychological support, which is needed in this moment. The second thing is an enlightenment to show the way out. And that means maybe you could also ask one of the experts, maybe a psychologist or someone who understands that situation, so you will help this person out. Another point here that we need to see as well and understand the context and the reasons that put this person in that struggle. Sometimes we take the situation lightly, and maybe we will be judgmental to those people, and we don't actually study the reasons why they went the way they went through. I think it's good as well, if you want to help the person, you see the context that puts this person into this struggle. So be tender, enlighten the way, ask for good advice from psychologists or people who has experience in this, and study the context of this person so you can deal with the situation in a good way. And pray for this person, because this is a very hard struggle, and then it needs a lot of support from above.
A very brief question, just we must finish within a few minutes. Since we don't know how to get up again and get closer to God, so how? I want to get closer to God. I don't know how. Actually, it's just I read a parable or a story that somebody was a guest in a house, and the owner of the house left him for a while in the sitting room, and the guest started to look from the doors in the behind and the glass of the doors, looking a very beautiful farm, a very very beautiful, you know, green pastures, and very, and then was looking through the glass of the window for more than half an hour. Amazing view. And then the owner of the house came. And when he came down, you found him looking. He said to him, Yes, I admire it. I wish to go out, but I couldn't. Aloha, you couldn't. Just push the door, it was open. In many cases, we need just to not to knock the door, to push the door, because knocking, that's asking. Pushing, that's needing. Needing and, you know, giving the decision that I want to go through this place and utilize the atmosphere outside and the blessings of the Lord outside. Thank you very much for that. We can go with our program afterwards. But I wish to give big hands to our last bishops.